edition of KTS Newscast. This newscast is more packed than the delivery of Easter eggs we saw trundling to Mr. Ullman's abode.
And more wholesome than a year 8 developed quiche.
Yum. One lad who wouldn't quake an open-faced pastry crust is Matthew Cook. Rugby star Matty has some exciting news.
Then we talk to Ben Whitten to find out more about cystic fibrosis.
I meet up with Chloe Hammond to find out about her recent art trip to Paris and see her amazing pictures.
After that, we're bringing back the much-missed 60-second news.
But before all that, with the centenary year of World War I fast approaching, KTS Newscast investigates the local legacy of this war to end all wars.
A century ago, on the 28th of July 1914, war broke out in Eastern Europe. It ravaged the continent and proceeded to drag the rest of the world into it, giving this conflict the title of the Great War, and later the more famous First World War. Although the First World War started 100 years ago and appears very far away, newscasts wondered if the war was closer than it seemed. In reality, our town was home to many brave soldiers. The war memorial in Baldock serves as a reminder to the selfless men who fought for our freedom. They endured terrible conditions, fighting for their lives all over Europe. We set out to find the private peace wall of Baldock. Using the censuses of today, we managed to track down a Percy Charles Bray, a soldier serving in the Royal Army. He was born, and lived in, Baldock, on Bygrave Road. Percy was in the Bedfordshire Regiment, in the 2nd Battalion. He served as a Lance Corporal on the North Western Front, in Belgium, near Ypres. After around 4 years of fighting, he suffered a serious injury while in combat within the trenches. Tragically, he died of his wounds just 5 months from the end of the war. His grave is in the Baldock Cemetery. We asked KTS students and staff about their very own war heroes.
My great-great-uncle served in the Somme in 1916 with the 4th Manchester Infantry. He was gassed in 1916 and sent home. After this, he had breathing problems. He died in 1922.
One of them served in the Somme and died because of a gas attack in the Somme, and the other one served in a place called Bayeuxville, which is in France, near a place called Nord, and also died because of a gas attack. They were both riflemen and one was a corporal.
My gran, Ruby Whitehead, used to live in London, and in the First World War she told us something that she remembered. And it was Zeppelins flying over London, these huge airships, and she said everybody went out to watch. People in the parks gathered in groups and people followed them. These were German Zeppelins flying over London, which then started throwing bombs out. And people still didn't know what was happening and still followed them. She said it was almost like a party, until of course they started hearing explosions and worked out what was happening, and then there was a bit of panic. But she saw the first Zeppelin, first bombing raid, over London.
What was your relative's name?
His name was Clement Golding.
Where did he serve?
At the First Ypres.
Did he survive the war?
Yeah, he did.
KTS Newscast discovered that the Great War was closer than we thought.
Thank you for that insightful piece. Next up, we interviewed Matthew Cook about an amazing rugby opportunity he has been offered.
Over to Jonathan Warman, who caught up with Matthew to tell us more.
Year 8 rugby star Matthew Cook has some exciting news. Matthew Cook was ranked last season 6th in the country for his event, Hammer Throw. However, it is rugby that Matthew truly loves. The Letchworth and KTS number 8 has been asked to go to a specialist rugby school. I catch up with him to find out more.
So Matthew, I hear you're leaving us.
Yeah, I am. I'm really happy to get a sports scholarship to Haileybury College.
So how did you get into rugby?
I started when I was about 4 or 5. My dad took me up to Letchworth. Started playing with my brother's age, 2 years above, and just really enjoyed it.
Rugby is a dangerous sport. Have you had any injuries?
Yeah, I've had a few of my tendons ripped. I've had broken knuckles, broken hand completely, dislocated fingers and broken noses.
Ben Whittam is one of the most inspirational students at KTS. He suffers from cystic fibrosis, but Ben continued his life as normal without complaining. Recently, he starred in a national ad charity campaign to publicise his condition. I met him to find out more.
That's why we use the Cystic Fibrosis Trust forum.
I have trouble absorbing nutrients, so I have to eat tons of food.
You went on the trip as part of your photography subject. When did you go to Paris?
It was Tuesday the 18th of February until the Friday the 21st.
How did you get there?
We got the coach from school at 5 o'clock in the morning, and then we got the coach to St Pancras and got the Eurostar to France.
How quick did you get to France?
It's about 2.5 hours. It actually went really quick. We were all so excited.
What was the best thing you think you took a photo of for your project?
I think the Eiffel Tower looked pretty good. I know this is quite a cliche shot, but it's just so different in real life, and yeah. It was just nice to take pictures of it.
And who went on the trip?
It was art and photography students, so we had most year 13s, one year 12, and then quite a lot of year 11s.
What teachers went with you?
Miss Kennedy, Miss Stokes, Miss Pace, and Miss Adonovich.
And so what else did you do while you were in Paris apart from photography?
Yeah, we did sightseeing. We went to quite a few museums, art museums and photography museums, and then the obvious like sightseeing places like the Louvre, the Eiffel Tower and Sacré-Cœur, so it was really nice to go there.
When you went up the Eiffel Tower, did you make it to the top?
Yeah, we made it to the top. Thankfully, we didn't have to climb the stairs because we've been up since 5 a.m. So you went on the first day? So we went on the first day, which was quite tiring, but we got to the top by the lifts, which were quite quick, so it was good.
And the most memorable moment?
I'd have to say Sacré-Cœur on the second night, which is like an area of Paris with a church, and it overlooks like a load of Paris that you can see so many buildings. And the good thing about that was we got there about 6 o'clock and it was getting dark. And then we had a bit of free time, so everybody wandered off and there was a busker by the step. By the time we came back, two of the girls that were on the trip, there was Ayn Rand and Phoebe, they'd got hold of the guitar and the busker's music system and they were like singing and stuff. It was a really nice night.
As part of the Easter fundraising, the EST is planning to sell chocolate eggs. With a difference. These scrumptious Easter treats have been laid by the KTS chickens. Joe Royal reports.
So sir, can you explain why the chickens have been laying chocolate eggs?
Yeah, apparently in the air in Bordeaux there's a lot of radon gas, and radon apparently is a mutation causing gas in the air. So as a result, what we've discovered is that the chickens that are in Bordeaux have started to produce eggs that rather than being made of calcium carbonate, like most eggs, are actually made of calcium chocolate, like this egg just here. Now, as I'm sure you appreciate, it tastes delicious.